when it was Kemet, Black Egypt. It wasn't Nile Valley Civil, Black Egypt. Like and subscribe, Black Egypt. It wasn't no Mediterranean culture, like and subscribe. You gon' get tormented for 4 minutes if it's war when it just said Jesseru got a false door in it. The Nubian flow, that's before Kemet. My Sakim T got rubies and gold, and it's fit for a Kushite king. But what it look like, the green Sahara ring bearer bring terror to your satellite kingdom, so they do not bother me. Scarification look like wavy line pottery. Kush with the black top pots, a rap top notch, and I could kick you till your laptop stops. I'm like Tahaka, Shabaka, or Pianchi, the author's a father. Any cocky, I came down to now through the lands of Kush, living a pre-dynastic Pharaoh way and Marrow way. Kerma, Khartoum, or Semna by the fifth cataract. Now I put the fifth wheel on the Cadillac. So much rod, a white man couldn't battle that though, they had to paddle back. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
You gotta look and see where the Nile started.
Black Egypt.
And how it was easier to go downstream than upstream. And watch where the river flow. Don't look at the color, look at the culture.
Black Egypt.
What you know about Dynasty 00? Roll through with Shimsu, hey, room on the standard. Ta-Nehisi, Sudanese G's. Try to test me. I'm an archer from Ta Seti. The squad ready, so I'm stepping in with the extra thin leopard skin. A tail on the apron with my crown on. You can crack jokes, but I ain't the one to clown on.
Ayo, Egypt was black, and that's a fact. All you little suckers need to step on back. They tried to throw us off, but we kept on track. We started doing research, what you slept on that?
And with Kemet, it don't matter what the name means. If it's a black culture, then that's the same thing. Race science is a lame thing. Ever since Nubian times, I let the chain swing. How the first gnome of Egypt was Ta Seti, but Ta Seti was Ta Seti already.
Yep, it meant the land of the bow, and when Egyptians needed archers, this is where they would go to recruit them.
But I
got arrows and I'll shoot them.
Who do me a favor, like the video.
Recruit them and you serve them. Black Egypt.
Black just sharing Egypt. My morning research, we gon' chill.
Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
Like and subscribe.
Black Egypt.
Like and subscribe.
Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
Upper Egypt boy, got that white crown, Upper Egypt boy. Babylonian bars, Ugaritic spit it, get it, dagger on me. That harpoon, it ain't for abalone. Phoenician pieces made of Nubian gold. Antediluvian scrolls hit the Nubian poles. And if you wanna debate that, you'll get truly exposed. I'm like the king of Axum, Axum. Bring the maxims of Ptah back to action. I actually swing my axe, so Y-axis, 32 degrees west on the Y-axis. Try and catch us, Christianity was stolen from Kemet, lying bastards. Compare the Book of Psalms to Amenope. Sometimes I'm rhyming, I'm just like a shaman, okay? I rock the white crown, say Tashima. You rock the red crown, say Tameho. You rock the white crown, say Tashima. You rock the red crown, say Tameho. I'm a star charting Bantu boy with my bow and arrow. I raise a king in my gnome if I don't know the pharaoh. Explosive and lethal in your dreams like Joseph the Hebrew. And no sending evil, why jet and neck bent? Here to ward that off, I'm not a sage burner. Scroll learner, the page turner. The script writer, put the pen down, cause I don't fucking need it. Cause I got the white crown, the Upper Egypt.
What up with my peoples this morning?
You rock the red crown.
Say, top mech, you rock the white crown.
Say, touch you rock the red crown.
See, it's all about bringing it to your people.
I'm a C-group, Magi Archer, from Ta-Nehisi. You conscious community pseudos never try to test me. Cause I'm in Ross Squad up. Fuck religion. And when I'm on the mic, don't cut my wisdom, boy.
Don't cut my wisdom, bro.
Du Bois, I'll smother you under the Sphinx heat.
All right, let's stop right there. Hold on.
Ancestrally cooking up mean lyrics.
I said I'm W.E.B. Du Bois, and I felt like stopping right there. It's because, how y'all doing this morning first? Let me get that out there. How is everyone? Because we heard a lot of slander thrown on Du Bois' name. over the time. But if you go into some of his documents, this is the one I want people to study. Du Bois, not Versus, and Du Bois and Flinders Petrie. I'm gonna be streaming from back here in a minute, dealing with my eyes and shit. But Du Bois and Flinders Petrie, here you go. Letters from Flinders Petrie to Du Bois. Come on, y'all. That's because Du Bois was banging back in the day. He read up some of the stuff that Petrie was putting out in regards to with racial concerns. Racial concerns. Don't think I'm going to talk about nothing about that shit and that stupid ass shit with that racist motherfucker. This the wrong channel. Excuse my language, but this is just a channel so you can get away from that nonsense. All I can say in that regard is everyone should always be prepared, but you can't even be prepared for silly nonsense like that. If you don't live in a place where you could be walking around strapped, then that's even crazy. But what made me thinking about that was these, actually it's just one big thing if you really want to dig it. Because we be fighting against pseudoscience, believe it or not, and people think that's irrelevant. But every premise that the shooter or the killer just went on was a result of pseudoscience. I hate to say it. So it's different ways to approach and different ways to address things. The pseudoscience that was alive to thrive in the ideology of racism coming up out of Germany where the white man is about to die and all that shit. That was the pseudoscience that was allowed to thrive that enabled what happened to happen. But anyway, that ain't my vibes. So right here we see at, I don't know, this UMass library, letters from Flinders Petrie to Du Bois. And we got correspondences back from Du Bois to Petrie. And in the documents, again, this is just like trying to read Metal Netter, trying to read somebody old ass cursive. Like who could just read that all the way? Dear sir, what does it say after dear sir? But they got this translated too. And you see it say race here. So somebody noted that this is a discussion about race between W.E.B. Du Bois and Flinders Petrie. So eventually we'll get into that work, but I only was led on that because I said in that song, I'm W.E.B. Du Bois. And cats didn't actually. I figure some people might still be looking at Du Bois from an old light. But that ain't what I was on. I was looking at, my daughter, I started early because my daughters ain't even left for school yet. Shout out for all the early people like me. Getting your kids together, I mean, you know, getting the household together up early. Shout out to everybody at work right now, supporting yourself and your family. Are the people who, you know, setting up, doing stuff to set up their businesses this morning. Retired people just chilling. Freelance people like myself. Entrepreneurs, what's up with y'all today? I'll tell you, with me, I wake up every morning. The first thing, since I work with people in a different time zones on the other side of the world, I work up every morning anticipating, conversations with developers on a project I'm working on. And so sometimes we have morning dialogues, and after that, I'm straight to the studying. When I put up a song like the Black Egypt song, it does help me do more of this. Because just like we see others, we can't be silly. You can't sit around studying all day doing, free classes or whatever on YouTube and just letting your pockets deteriorate. You know what I'm saying? Because your vocation or your passion is drawn to do something that might cut into the time that is to build up on your prosperity. And so throughout my life, I learned how to merge the two, and we all should. And I'm proud of anyone who, you know, who knows how to not let certain things slip while they're focusing on their vocations. We got a vocation and an occupation. Your vocation being what you're naturally drawn towards to do. Your occupation normally is what occupies your time to make a living. So this is like a vocation of mine, you know? And when I was looking over our collections in the Louvre right now, well, it'd be a very good thing to go over how to pull up the primary accounts concerning, particularly concerning any primary. I often, in my own research, like if I'm gonna put something and print it, You would want to do the good work to definitely not trust the sources and go look at the primary. But right here, I'm on the Louvre's collection page, or however you pronounce that museum. And I'll actually share it in the chat for those, because it's kind of not the easiest page to find. You can find it, but sometimes if you just go to collections, it wouldn't lead me to this page where you can simply type to find certain primaries of certain things. And so when looking for some primaries on the term Kemet, the black lamb, I found myself here. Yeah, still early because I still hear hella behaviors in the house. So I find myself here, and I was looking over the primary account of one at the station. But here's the difference, and this is what we got to realize. It's really hard, and I'm just going to say to you, this is what you got to do. Look, you see the condition of this primary? Being an armchair scholar sitting at the house, you know what I'm saying? This is what you got. In the future, they'll probably be able to use augmented reality, and the stellar will appear right in your face in your house when you put on your 3D goggles. But right now we're looking at a 2D plane, and it's very hard. You can, like, it's really homework to be able to make out what all these glyphs say. But scholars have done it, and they got processes where they, you know, they use liquids, all kind of stuff, and make imprints, chalk outlines, all different things to figure out what these other signs were, as well as comparing them to other stella and what have you. So at that link I just shared, you could just, if you know the name of the part of the, like, I just typed Kemet in here, and it's taking me close to all the attestations they have just right in the Louvre. And that's the one I was at. This was a person called, I forgot they said Kimenez, but I couldn't find it on the primary because of the condition. So yesterday, I started reading an article by a Professor Capocicci at Harvard. I think he got his PhD in linguistics in Paris. And, oh, here's the other one. I think he got his PhD in Paris, and he has two documents concerning the term Kim and Kemet. So yesterday I just started to dive into one of them. But let me say something though, because it's still morning, we still rolling in, letting the people come in, like the video. We don't wanna roll into everything too fast and just, it's 6 in the morning, what, 7 in the morning out here. Some people just rolling. If you get out the bed at like 10 o'clock, where you at, you either, you doing good. You must be young. You doing really good. Are you behind? Ain't no other two. If you're getting out the bed, or you might be sick for the day. Getting out the bed, man, at like 11, 12. I'm not judging nobody. I'm just giving some examples that there are morning hours where you could get things done and accomplished. So I think I'm going to try, what I'm going to try to do here before we get into the Kent Kim, this is another primary. This is the primary account of the text that talks about the beautiful woman and describes her hair as blacker than the darkness of night and blacker than the grapes in the field of Kemet or whatever. But they don't say Kemet. They just say blacker than the grapes of Kemet or whatever, or of the land or whatever. Grapes in the vineyard. So it'd be hella funny because scholars be having to do stuff that if we put our body, our minds to it, I'm going to try to make this as big as I can. If we put our minds to it, we'd have to, you got to respect the body of work that these people have done in order to come to certain conclusions. Whoever these people includes, you could be one of those people. And so this is how I match this up. Just so I want to show some people a few things because all of these tools work together in conjunction, right? So here I got Menkaure Eni. So to use the Love tool, obviously with the Sars lingua aegypti, it's fairly simple, but I'm going backwards, but because normally you start with the research tool that'll show you the facsimile, and then you could push it towards the primary. But let's see if I can find that name in here. It probably won't pop up just like that because I got it. Let me see. Let's see if that happens. Menkaure. All right, there we go. So we got a Menkaure. I don't know if this is going to be the same one. It says, we really want Menkaure any. Let's see. I'm going to click into, there's plenty of Menkaure's, but kind of wanted to show how I got to that. I know how I got to the attestation. So this is what I'll show. Skin, right? No. I'm just going to go to black. How everybody doing that's coming in, rolling in. You know, our morning classes, we do them in our commute. Anybody listening to me in a commute, what's up? I hope you got a smooth commute. Anybody just waking up, how you doing tapping in today? So basically I'm just showing, and you know what? I used to always do this, but then Shagan Degu Kemi pointed something out to me the other day and I was happy he did so that we could stay on, you know what I'm saying? Stay on our toes and not start relying on the sources without actually doing the backup work to prove your point. And so what I'm looking for here is a statement where they're talking about how this woman's hair, and they really was propping this woman up. Like they even was like, they described her to a T. Her posture and physique. And I was like, dang, they put all this on the Stella. And so just let me find, here we go. So say I found the account here, right? Her hair is blacker than the black of night, than the grapes of Egypt. Now see, this is a cool one because it says black twice and it also says Egypt. And so you wanna go see if they say Kemet. You feel me? Or Kemet, like they do wordplay. But apparently enough here, it says Adeb is the word used for Egypt here, but really this translation of Egypt is a liberal one by Egyptologists, because when we click into this link, it just says the two banks. And so when we start to look at Egypt as a riparian zone, we have to wonder what qualifies us moving, because the two banks is defined as a riparian zone in ancient Egyptian dictionaries and also referred to as one. Is somebody here? Hold on. Hold on, y'all. Let me just close the door. You feel me? All right. YouTube. Oh, so yeah. So exactly that. And so when I go back now, so this is where I was at. Because I was like, her hair is blacker than the black of night, blacker than the grapes of Egypt. And then I'm looking over here. I'm like, check this out. Let's get into this text. So we go co-text to get more information on the text, right? Nope, let me go back. First, we go to text. And it's going to give us more information on the text. In the bibliography, we can see all the works that they have on this document, on this attestation for blacker than the black of night. All these people say what page numbers they addressed it on. So really having a tool like this, it do half your homework for you, because I've been not knowing certain things and had to go looking all over the internet trying to find certain, you know, sources or whatever, or so they got a collection of them right here. And so then they'll tell you the line count, where it's on, blah blah blah, and where it should tell us where it is currently located. So here up on the information for the text, we see this is right here. Normally you could just take this. I think I got to the text by copying this and popping it into the link I shared at the load. Or whatever, however you pronounce it. Is that right? So I didn't get there by that. Maybe I took out the C. Or if not, I think I just put in the name of the person of the text. Yeah, because this isn't leading me there. And so, let me see. So I didn't do it by putting him in Kepera, but I know I could. Oh, yes, I did. I put him in Kepera any again, which is this pharaoh, right? And it takes me to, so let's just go back. Men. There you go right there. So when you type men, even if you're on the search, it'll give you all the options. Foundman, Captain Ra, any, and then we get to the primary account of this story. So we can now go through the text and match it up line by line. And in order to do that, we get back out of here and starting at the co-text. And so to see if this text is right, we see Baal-Det, the great god, the lord of heaven. And then we go back to the primary. All right, so let me close some pages so I won't be have to keep doing this and move this over here. So you see the Baal-Det up here are the winged horse, and it says that right here. Baal-Det, Baal-Det. But again, when we look in that primaries, you see how hard it is to really make stuff. So they get in there and they do the homework and come up with it. But now we have the qualified translations as well as the primary for us to be able to investigate. And so if we look at the numbering, because we want to get to this one line where they're talking about the blackness of her hair and all that. And really, to keep it truth, I don't even want to say nothing, blood. It do say hair. I'm tripping. It actually say hair. So let's go look. Her hair is blacker than the black of night, than the grapes of Egypt. One thing I was investigating is the metaphor schemata between Kim and the blackness of night. not necessarily anything that had to do with appearances. It was more or less the, again, the metaphor between Kim, the blackness of night, and Egypt, which could have been called Kim in these instances, but was not. It was Ajeb, as they translated. So this line right here is actually this line right here in the text. And so this raises something really, really strange and peculiar, and I'd just be liking to talk about this. Because look at this Kemet sign that scholars have translated as the Kemet. It dang near looked like somebody made it into a Kemet out of a T. Look. So when you look at the primary, these are this one. This is supposed to be Kemet right here. You definitely see some lines coming out of it out over here. But we could clearly see this shape was similar to what they call a T right here. It seems as if the artist Stan or somebody who carved this used the similar whatever type of, I don't know if they was using like, eventually we have to be wise and know that they had some type of template, yo, something to make this bird look exactly like this bird. It seems as if eventually they would have had some type of impression tool, but I'm just making that up just out of my head right now. I'm telling y'all that. But it would only stand to say that he didn't carve this with a pencil and then carve it again perfectly with a pencil. They probably had some type of impression tool to make glyphs. But again, I just said, I just pulled that out of thin air. But the reason why I'm saying that is because it seems as if this T, again, this isn't the traditional shape of the black crocodile skin. And if I could zoom in any more, others could see how this is somewhat of the type of anomalies that scholars have to consider. So they see it with, they see it like this, and then they see the M, they say black, right? Then we got sin. And when I do these type of just whatever morning workshop, I often like to have the dictionary open to corroborate what we're talking about. So for anyone who's just turned into the channel, this is the, okay, this is the phenomena we're discussing right now. And I'm gonna try to get to it so we can see in the dictionary. And shout out to any people who tuned in yet. I ain't had the chance to open up the chat since the show started, but I love all y'all and love y'all for supporting me. So do me a favor, like the video, so I can be more people in the morning courses. So again, this is what we're discussing, trying to see if this first glyph is actually this. Now, most of the times I see it, it has a straight back. It has a straight back here. That's most of the times when I see the, I keep calling it I-6, it is I-6. When I see the I-6 glyph, it has a straight back. And so we're trying to see if we see these two glyphs on the primary to see if it's well-defined as same black. So then when we go back to the primary, we look right here, and the only anomaly is that this does not have a straight back like it does in a lot of the other instances. But nevertheless, scholars conclude that this says black. And now this is a word, sin-e, S-N-I, I think. So let's see. There's a lot of S-E-N-I's. So instead of going through all of them, I'm gonna try to do a quicker search and say hair. All right, damn, that's more, it's more words for hair. There it goes. Luckily we got to it. Nope, that's not it. But that is a lock of hair. Notice that. All right, where's the SNI? Can I do SNI hair? Yep. There it go. SNI hair. I didn't know you could do that. All right, so look. You see this right here? This loopy thing. You see this like a strip of water, or you know, represents water. That's S, or the SH sound. This is an N. This is the ooh sound. So we got Sinu for hair. See if we'll see these right after that black word on the primary. See these right here? So this is what I want you to trip off. This is not your traditional hair determinative, okay? And cats be wondering, because I don't always be streaming live while I'm doing this. This is what I do. And so I might get some new knowledge by just tripping, like looking at the primaries, like, damn, why they got the symbol for a plant on a word for hair? So let's go back and look at the dictionary. And it's supposed to be this hair determinative. But on the primary account, it's not. It is a different determinant. It's a different one that we can use for a plant, which is the type of things we learn by only going over and looking at the thing. You see this? And so now we got to say, okay, well, let me see if I can find an account of the same word with that other glyph. Because it makes it an option. Let me see. So here's a combination of it meaning to argue, but what we want to find it with the plant glyph, the determinative. Emoji, classifier, whatever you want to call it. None of that matters. You feel me? I say emoji for the fun of it. It helps people to understand. And that's all it's about. So I'm looking through this term to see if we find it. There it goes. Here's one with you see what I mean? This one we're looking at has this plant determinative when supposedly talking about her hair. Now we can identify that this determinative is M2. It's M2. And I could just type M2 right here and see all the words that pop up in, right? Yep. And so then get back over here and make it smaller so that when I roll through it fast, I can just see, like, it pops up in hella words. Too many words, but. I mean, it says like 1,400 words, so I'm not about to do nothing like that. But, and it's always at the end of the page, so I got to make it smaller. So now, see, every attestation we look to now will have this hair, this plant glyph over there, and we will have to, the question is, oh, see, that's dope. See, they be clean, and so I'm looking at this right now, and it's used in a meadow, right? It's used for meadows. If we go back to the primary text, they're actually talking about her hair, but they're equating her hair to the blackness of night, and by the end they're going to equate it to the grapes in the field of Egypt. All right, this the blackness of night or whatever we just went through, and this is like some grapes in a field, but we're going to go over all of that. So it's like blacker than the grapes in the field is what they translated it as. But just for our little research, we tripping off why this hair got a plant glyph. Now, since they're talking about stuff in the field, and it say Kim, then they got something for hair, but it got actually a plant. You see what I mean? It could be going kind of metaphoric, because this is the second Kim, which means black. So it says Kim, like black hair. Well, we're gonna go back to the text. They say her hair is blacker than the black of night, than the grapes of Egypt. It really say the grapes in the riparian zone. It don't say Egypt. It say grapes in Ajeb or Adeb. which is the two banks of the river, a small little area. But let's keep going. I'm just getting my chill up. Then I'm going to check the chat, see who anybody's saying anything. I ain't going to get too stuck on that, but I just wanted us to see that. Here's supposed to be the second Kim right here, and it also looked like it was formed from some type of, used to look like a T. But maybe it's just because I can't see it in person. The K and the M in Gur. So black in the night or the black of the night. Now let's go look up this ire. It's supposed to be like grapes. Instead of having to go look it up, we could just go right back to grapevines, grapes, raisins. Now, what if it was saying blacker than the raisins? See, that's what I'm saying. It's the same thing because a grape is a fresh raisin. But still, they was using metaphors back then concerning her hair color. Well, so what's up? Party people in the house. Glad to see some people in the building early morning. So what we'll do again is reintroduce the work of, what's up? We're going to reintroduce the work of Dr. Sandro Capocci and look over some, yeah, the taco song. And we're going to look over some of the stuff that he said. Yeah, it wasn't looking like a taco right there. That's what I was saying. That's what I was saying, Corey. It wasn't. That's what I was like. This ain't looking like who? Well, I mean, it was looking like in my household we call them blocos because we make black tacos and they taste different than Mexican tacos. So I asked my wife if she gonna make some blocos. You use ground beef, American cheese, all kind of other ingredients. But the joke is that in order to identify this I-6 glyph, some people said it looked like a taco. And so, yeah. All right, now, back to the good brother scholar. And if I Google his name, why not just start from there? Oh, you know what? I'll be having a lot of stuff. Let's just do this. Pull that text up. Then go to. This is the brother we were looking over his work. We're at Harvard Ed right now. And the brother is Sandro Capocci, PhD candidate studying historical African arts with a focus on bite and benign areas in West Africa. I said he received his MA in art history and archaeology from the University of Paris. Pantheon Sorbonne in 2019. His dissertation there dealt with the 18th century royal art of the kings of Dahomey and their intersection with national identity, imperialism, and metaphysics. Sandro also received a PhD in linguistics from the University of Paris in 2019, and hopes to use this field of research as a tool for better understanding of African art history. Interesting that the good brother wants to use his degree in linguistics for better understanding of African art history. So when we started to dive into one of his documents yesterday, is this the one? Let me go see. I want to do the other one first. Because I was halfway through it. It's this. We were going through a document he wrote. We were going through a document he wrote on Kim where he was making on Kim, the Black Soil, where he was making very good points and giving us a point of reference for all the new scholars who have been addressing this term. I just brought my good brother's book the other day and got a notification from Amazon that it'll be here tomorrow. And so I will be able to look through that newer work on the subject as well. But not to have to read it over from the top, I'm going to share the link for anyone in the chat who wants to go over this for themselves and even use his work as a point of reference. Hell no, we ain't gonna talk about no fucking payback. You on the wrong show, cornball. Like, are you an agent? Fuck, we talk payback. Come on, bro. Go do your payback right now, and then live stream. Nah, I don't even want to say that. But come on with that, bro. We're in a classroom. There are other classes going on in America right now. Go walk into any of them and ask them if they're going to talk about some payback. But as far as that's concerned, just do what you can do in your own personal life, Brother Jamal, in order to make sure your family is secure. And if you got to be walking around if it got to be on you, it got to be on you. But it ain't nothing nobody got to say about that besides rest in peace to the people that were harmed. Straight up. This ain't no... Why do people be thinking when you're talking about Kemet or Egypt or something that this like a got something to do with militants or something? We all got to deal with the impact that any egregious attack on people, whatever mental stress or burden that puts on you, you got to deal with it. But I don't think changing the discourse to something like that is going to be productive for my channel. I don't do that shit. That's silly. It's dumb. Like, who broadcasts that type of stuff? So when I see statements like that, I don't particularly think the person, I didn't want to say nothing about agent like that, but you got what I mean, a provocateur, a person who will push the conversation in the direction that will possibly lead to other things than us discovering what we're here to discover. So I don't want to come down too hard on you, but that ain't what we're here for. As the show would have been titled something about that. It's hella people who want them current event views. It's just different channels. You know how you watch a TV show? You turn on the TV, something you ain't see, you just change channel. You don't talk to the TV and say, can we put on a different show? No, you just change channel. And so this show, we're focusing on things that'll help people get their mind off of those type of stresses. You feel me? But I mean, like I say, keep it on you and just be cool. You was in that grocery show, you had it on you, then you in the middle of a video game. What you gonna do? He was in the middle of his video game. I've been in them video games. I'm gonna do what I do on the sticks. I mean, what? It's like, you know? But according to Diop, no, I wasn't at no according to Diop. I just was basically breaking down some of the points the good brother made about Kemet, and particularly not to have to read over it. He went over Diop's work. I shared it. He's just laying out conclusions people have come to. And one good point he made about the equivalence to the black land and the soil of how man comes out of the black soil from the Kemetic perspective. If we think about Kanum and making man out of the ground, we also have to compare it to a proto-Sinaitic equivalent with their term red and how they were also made from the clay and depict a red-hued people. And so this is not my statements, but these are some of the things we can find that I was reading yesterday in a document. And I think we got down to this Etils or Etiles, gender incompatibility as an argument for Kim not being a reference to the color of the soil. Some people talk about this feminine T at the end, but I shared the article, and when you start to read the article, you'll see that there was also work concerning the feminine T on Kemet that offers a very good explanation for some of these things. And so I'm just trying to get back to kind of like where we were the other day, yesterday, so we can get to the bottom of these things. So here we go. Let's start from Red Earth and Man in Semitic. And this is the work of Adia Konoff. In his work in Prehistory of Semitic Languages, Adia Konoff recalled the derivation of Semitic words for red man and earth from the same Proto-Semitic root Adam. So let's just be clear. In the Semitic languages, this scholar, a Russian scholar, is proposing that the color red, man, and earth come from the same Proto-Semitic root, something like Adam. In particular, the Hebrew word Adam meant man, and Adamat, red earth, and Adam to be red are derived from it. In the other most famous Semitic languages, Arabic, we find the root Adam with whatever, with the roots and words Adam to mean to be brown, Adim skin, and Adamat, human skin. Adamat is hard ground or without stone. In agreement with the biblical account in which Adam, the first man, is created from earth, Diakonoff explains that the etymological relationship between the red earth, man, and his skin tones come from the fact that God would have created the human being from the red earth, and that he and the first speakers of Semitic languages or their ancestors would have considered themselves to have red skin. The Russian linguist extends this self-identification of red-skinned people to the ancient Egyptians. But regardless of whether the Russian linguist did that or not, he's laying out somewhat of a strong case for a Proto-Semitic equivalent where they're using a color. I mean, they get the roots for a color, they get the roots for man and earth in the same from the same root. He first does so on a linguistic basis by claiming that the Semitic root Adam to be red is related to the Egyptian word for skin, Anim. Then he does so on a representations of men in ancient Egyptian art, which he describes as red and brown. The ancient Egyptians, he said, would have considered themselves to be red-skinned like the first speakers of the Semitic language. Now he says, Diakonoff's hypothesis is problematic in many ways. The Semitic root Adam is probably not related to the Egyptian Anim skin. It is more likely related to the Egyptian Adim in red linen. Nor is the idea of redness intrinsically associated with the Egyptian word Anim. It is much more likely that the latter is related, for example, to the Berber Ayilim or whatever skin, for which the phonetic correspondence and the meaning makes it a perfect parallel. So we keeping up with him. We're gonna get through it, but this shit long. Damn. It says, oh, so we got past all of this yesterday anyway, but let's just keep it popping. Another problem is the following. In English, the color adjective used to refer to skin of ancient Egyptian men is the same used to refer to the color of blood and bricks. These are the red and brownish. Diakonoff seems to assume that this was necessarily the case in ancient Egypt, but it wasn't. It was an assumption. So he's showing here, I'm just going to talk through this part. He shows here how the word Kim is used for the red crown of Upper Egypt, even though we know this color is called Jasher. So sometimes I go watch my homies' videos and I'll be like, damn, they must have unsubscribed or they must have stopped watching me because they sitting there teaching their community shit that their community could come right to my page and see that shit is debunked. Just last night, I heard somebody talking about, look here, see? Here go the color of Mentuhotep. And look on the statue. You see the different color? And I just did a video with primary documentation showing that that is foolishness. So how would you sit in the class? If you sitting there watching me do this and you come to a conclusion that what I'm saying is true, I'm showing you PhD scholars that say it. Right here, several examples show us this wasn't the case. In ancient Egypt, the crown of Upper Egypt was called heads traditionally, right? While the red crown was called Jeshurun. Hedge is white, Jeshurun is red. These two terms refer to the white and red colors of the two crowns. But in context comparing them, the red is presented as Kemet, Emet, equaling city, literally the darker Kemet of the two crowns. So when we say that we got a version of the red crown called Kim, and we don't understand that, and we like, well, why is the red crown called Kim? I was like, you show me what you ain't read. The red crown is called Kim because you don't understand the spectrum that Kim represents. Kim could just mean dark or darker, as well as black. Black is included in dark. But all dark hues, even this red crown, since it's darker than the white one, is called Kim. I mean, come on. So don't let nobody show you nobody red skin on the wall and be like, well, why they ain't painted? If they Kim, then why they not painted black? You got enough knowledge to say, man, that's lightweight crazy. You feel me? So, yeah, we went over a lot of this yesterday. I want to get down to make progress, get down to the color. But anyway, in this part, he's saying about the word you share translates to the German red and blah, blah, blah. I'm just not wanting to go over a lot of material I went over yesterday. But here they're talking about how they use Kim and forehead to show brown color foreheads. And this is another scholar called Hangin. In their dictionary, they translate Kim as brown. It says, I follow Shinku's and Hangnig's translation of Kim, in this case, as brown. So we have a PhD scholar here showing us other sources where Kim, like Kemet, the root of Kemet, is translated as brown, but which, of course, could have as well been translated by black, without any prejudice about the possibility of ancient Egyptians having charcoal-like black skin. This is a linguist, by the way. Graduated, PhD. The reddish-brown color characteristics of the skin of the Egyptian men in pharaonic art mentioned by Diakonoff, in which he supposed would have been translated to the Egyptian language cognate as dim to be red, is in fact translated by the Egyptians as Kim, to be black, checkmate, mate. Golly, I be hating to do this to people. Morning fun, y'all. Who in the gym right now? Somebody might be in the gym. Shout out to the person who in the gym right now listening to this knowledge. Get on them push-up. Wah. I need to get on them shups. Get on them shups. Let's read this line again. I send out love to the person in the commute, because you're chilling right now listening to this. Love to the person in the gym. If you about to stop, do like one more minute. Go, keep going. And anybody who's just chilling at their house, morning breakfast, or maybe whatever, this is great. Let's read this again. The reddish brown, again, this is Dr. Sandro Capocicci, who says the reddish brown color characteristics of the skin of Egyptian men in pharaonic art mentioned by Diakonoff, in which he supposes would have been translated into the Egyptian language as the cognate for the Semitic dim to be red, is in fact translated by the Egyptian Kim, who be black. You hear what he said? So every statue, every poster, everything somebody showed you and said, well, why they red? Well, why they red? They proved that they didn't know this knowledge right here. Now, and he gives a source on that. The latter is rather cognate with Semitic or Syriac, ukama, black, and the Talmudic Hebrew, ukam, or ukama, black. Tacitus, or whatever, Tacitus, 1999. So this is a Jew. A jewel of the Nile. All right, tapped in with the chat. Peace, peace. Kaba. How you doing, sister? Yurik, what's up? Anuja, Asar, Mka. I seen you dropping bodies last night, boy. What's up, King Sosha? Seti out of place. I don't know what Seti doing right now. Corey the Atheist, Donnie Williams. What's up, y'all? Pseudo Killers in the building. J Mill in the building. You know what I'm saying? Yes, yes, yes. So fresh, so fresh. The ladder. So look. This is what I'm about to do. I'm about to go like this. Hold up. This one I was just editing a video yesterday. But I need to get out of Creative Studio and go right to my channel, right? No, I don't even need to go to my channel. This is what I want to do. Look at my history. I'm just going to play something I was watching real quick. Just for a quick. And y'all can come back and watch this dude's video. Where it go, man? It's hella long. I wasn't watching it that long ago, was I? Because I got to run into the room and grab me a water and something else. But it's this video I want y'all to see that I was just watching the other day that I can't even find in my thing. Oh, it had to have been earlier. I mean, dude, I watched so many YouTube videos. You know how when they show you how many hours you watched? They be like, you have watched 30,000 hours. So this is just one. I'm going to just play this like a commercial. But I guarantee you're going to like what dude is saying in the video while I'm playing it like a commercial. Of course, I watch every one of y'all videos. Even if you got three people in the stream, know that I'm one of those people. Don't ever think that I ain't. All right, I can't find it. So for my little, don't go nowhere, man, I swear. Just let me do this real quick. Be right back.
Upper Egypt, boy. Got that white crown. Upper Egypt, boy. Babylonian bars, you the Riddick spit it, get it, dagger on me. That harpoon, it ain't for abalone. Phoenician pieces made of Nubian gold. Antediluvian scrolls hit the Nubian poles. And if you wanna debate that, you'll get truly exposed. I'm like the king of Axum, Axum. Bring the Maxims of Ptah back to action. I actually swing my axe, so Y-axis, 32 degrees west on the Y-axis. Try and catch us, Christianity was stolen from Kemet, lying bastards. Compare the Book of Psalms to Amenope. Sometimes I'm rhyming, I'm just like a shaman, okay? I rock the white crown, say Tashima. You rock the red crown, say Tameho. You rock the white crown, say Tashima. You rock the red crown, say Tameho. I'm a star charting Bantu boy with my bow and arrow. I raise a king in my gnome if I don't know the pharaoh. Explosive and lethal in your dreams like Joseph the Hebrew. And no sin to evil, why jet and that bet? Here to ward that off.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Where was we at? Let's get back to it. I mean, I was going through this one slow, but we making good points and we showing references for good points. And so it ain't no big deal. Actually, this is the other document. So what happened? Went downstairs and came back to the other document. There we go. I like the points made here, and we need to bang this in the ground, okay? Don't let nobody come at you with that pseudoness who don't know nothing about the colors. Particularly on the screen, ain't just my words. These are words of a PhD on top of all of us. All right, so don't even come with that. Like, he's giving you the source work and not even laying out his case, more or less showing us what we've all said. And this line is particularly crucial in the specific case in comparison with the white crown. The red crown has been described with the word Kim, most often translated as black. So when somebody tried to ask me and I told them that and they felt me though, I gotta give my brothers their props because people didn't argue to this. When they said, what color is he? And they pointed at a Jasher dude on a dude who was supposedly painted Jasher on the wall with the so-called red hue. And my answer was Kim, because Kim represents a dark hue. It don't matter. It could be dark yellow. If it's darker than the lighter yellow, it is called Kim, as we see from this attestation of the red crown of Jesharet being called Kim. So somebody gonna be doing like, what? Give me a source on that. See, we gonna show you how to use the tools, and we can show you how you speed beat them up. While they're talking about microwaves and stuff, I'll show you how to speed beat them up. Because once you get to the bottom of this, it ain't no place else to go. See what I mean? So someone be there like, well, the white crown, the red crown of Egypt was called. Well, here you go. This is how you speed beat them up. We already got to the red crown right here, right? Crown of Lower Egypt. All right. Kemet. Look, no attestations on that, first of all. So we back to dude, and we back to the word of us. So now you got to do what? You got to go look at the two images in the digital slip archive where they telling you Kim right here is the crown. All right. Do they give you the attestations on it? This say revelations. What is that talking about? So now we got to read that to get those attestations. And then we have another issue where Kim right here is the crown, and we see some a gold behind it. But nevertheless, we're going to go look at, we'll have to translate this and see what text this is where Kim is the crown. But what does that mean? We just got to the only attestations they got of it in under 1 minute. I dare you to go find more. So stop acting like that. It's right here. This is where we go and see again. I don't know German or whatever, but I would type this in the translator and go find that primary. All right. So about that, now we got the PhD's word on it. And we got a way that we could just write there and look to see. It ain't even no attestations on that, right? So you know your opponent really can't show no walls where it's at. No attestations. That means it's dictionary work. See? So then if you go into the dictionary, you got to see where the dictionary got that from. And they showing you right here. It's right here. So now you got one attestation of it on the wall saying Kim, but it's the red crown. Now we know that red could mean be black. Ding! Was that 2 minutes? Microwave done. The microwave done. Hey, go get the microwave. Ding! Store-bought burrito, boy. Store-bought burrito, your homework. When you can store bought burrito or somebody homework. All right, here we go. Several researchers detail what the color of the ancient Egyptian language, blah, blah, blah. I shared this article and I promote anyone to read it thoroughly. We're going to skip through because he got another one that addresses the black land more. And I read through all of this yesterday. So if anyone could just go to the video yesterday and get up to that. But I like reading it. So, yet it was very likely that in Southwest Asian, the Proto-Semitic emerged. On the other hand, in Africa, the color of the soil is typically red, with the exception of the Nile Valley, whose soil is black because of the sediment of the White Nile, hence the name Kemet of Egypt. Mm. So you got to argue against bro too now. He deduced that the development of the myth of creation of the red man from the red earth presented in the Bible must have developed in Africa in the language from which Semitic and other related languages such as Egyptian and Berber would have proceeded. If this was the case, we should find traces of this belief in Berber and Egyptian. Serinelli in 1957 proposed that the Amazi, the etymology used by the Berber speakers to refer to themselves, was derived from the Berber root Zwi. Pronunciation of these transliterations ain't a real thing. So however I say it, don't look too bad upon me. To be read, combined with a prefix M marking agent nouns. The meaning of the combination between the one who is red. So basically, scholars is coming up showing you that the people who grew up in the red areas who had lighter skin than Kim or dark had the same type of mental schemata between the land, man being created from the land, and being the color of that land. This hypothesis was rejected by Chalker in 1986, who argued that the W in the root for red never appeared in Amazine, and its various Takas in 2008 rejected this objection, citing that the ancient Libyan ethnonym attested in ancient Egyptian Meshwesh, traditionally regarded as a reflex of Amazine, whatever. That's interesting. That is kind of cognate, huh? All right. Diakonoff presupposes, in our view correctly, that in order to be called red in reference to a member's skin color, a linguistic community must have been living around another of a different skin color, huh? So he says, Diakonoff proposes, in our view correctly, that in order to be called red in reference to a member's skin color, a linguistic community must have been living around another's of a different skin color. He assumed that in this specific case, the reds must have confronted with blacks in the prehistoric Sahara to be called that way. This is Diakonoff, a Russian's proposal. Some contemporary users of the Amazi, and its variants seem to be part of this dynamic. They were in fact reserved to lighter skinned populations as opposed to so-called blacks or mixed populations. Thus, although he considered this option of being a secondary development, Chalker in 1986 recalls that in certain Berber groups, there was a strong social stratification to reds, and the larger allogeneous Negroid population in southern Morocco and Algeria and Sahara. The word Amazigh used to specifically designate the white Berbers, the free man and the noble or the suzerain, it says, amongst the southern Tuaregs, as opposed to the blacks or mixed Berber speakers of inferior social status, he says, slaves, descendants of slaves, amongst the slave field workers, members of specific professional caste, musicians, butchers. So that was a Chalker or whatever. A similar argument can also be found regarding populations from North Africa west of Egypt, called by the Egyptians Timuhu. This ethnonym, I found that Champollion was the one who said that the Timahoo was Europeans. Just as a side note. I mean, y'all could have already knew that. This ethnonym attests as far back as the Old Kingdom. And it could be compared to the late Egyptian word Timahi, whose value would be red okra. The stem hypothetically common to these two words to him could be associated with the color red, confirming in a very fragmentary way the Konoff's hypothesis on the pre-Semitic origin of the ideas of the formation of the red man from the red earth among the first speakers of the Semitic language. So he's saying that could be a case. Now, black earth and people in Egyptian. If it does not confirm Diakonoff's hypothesis on the pre-Semitic origin of this idea, the Egyptian language confirms its existence at the level of the Proto-Semitic. The ancient Egyptians did not describe the reddish-brown skin of their men working in the sun with the equivalent word for red, but with the equivalent word for black. Damn, this is just beating. Oh man, all you gonna do is ignore these videos and the people, since y'all in the bushes now, not showing your face in the chat nowhere. You can act like you ain't seen it. So we gonna have to have this. Gonna have to come to a head. Cats ain't gonna be able to escape this. You know this gonna come to a head, right? You gonna have to show face and stand behind your work. I ain't even gotta write nothing. Why, who gotta put pen to paper when we find PhDs who put pen to paper that already confirm everything we saying? The ancient Egyptians, did not describe the red-brown skin of their men working in the sun with the equivalent word for red. Didn't I say that? Didn't I say, show me where it say Jasher next to one of those people that y'all keep calling red on the wall? Where have you seen a red person? They use the term black for that red color that anybody show you on the wall. So if somebody go after this video, they don't even have to know that they pseudo. You will know. They could go on and keep showing you pictures of Mentu Otep when he was black in one, and then when he was painted brown in another, and asking you, because they don't know that that whole spectrum is contained in the word Kim. They just don't know. Don't be mad at him. The term for black, Kim, was also used to describe the color of the soil of Egypt due to the silt in the form Kemet. Like Adam, which was created in the model from the red earth Adam, the Egyptians, Kemet to you, Remet in Kemet, or Kemet, were created and modeled according to the tradition recorded as early as the 5th dynasty by Khnum, the ram-headed god from the silt of Kemet. Khnum made man from the clay on the potter's wheel. Remember? Is the clay black? Now, I just don't like that he used this photograph representation, because this is not no original or whatever. But the distinction between the ancient Egyptians and the contemporary Asiatic speakers of the Semitic language is often found and represented in two by the former. And it says, Asiatics often appear lighter skinned than Egyptians, especially Egyptian men, whose skin is conventionally painted reddish brown, as opposed to the women, whose complexion conventionally range from white to yellow. That the conventional reddish brown complexion of the Egyptian men's prevailed over that of the women in the Egyptian self-definition is shown by the fact that the hieroglyphic depicting body parts did also characteristics reddish brown of the men and not the lighter skin tone characteristics of the women. All right, whatever. It says, complementing this opposition between lighter-skinned Asiatics and dark-skinned Egyptians in the latter's art, the biblical tradition presents speakers of the Semitic language as the sons of Shem and the Egyptians as the sons of Ham, that is, the darker-skinned populations. As we saw earlier, the feminine gender of Kemet, outside of the fact that toponyms are often treated grammatically as feminine nouns, even if they are not marked as such, is an enigma. Since the name originally refers to the Egyptian soil, the land, and the word for these, Ta, has a masculine gender in Egyptian. Linguists generally recognize a special relationship between the ancient Egyptian and Semitic. It would at least in part be the result of language contact during the Neolithic between populations of Northern Egypt in direct contact with Southwest Asia and populations further south. This contact would have led to Egyptians to share some of the striking similarities with Semitic. All right. So did these northern populations contribute to bringing the red man associated, created from the red earth, into the Egyptian language? If so, having arrived in a different geological environment where the soil was no longer red but black, they would have named their land Kemet, the gender of the latter having been inspired by that of Adam, red earth, and their demonyms Kemet, Kemetinu, and Remet in Kemet, made possible by the general dark skin tone of the Egyptians compared to the contemporary speakers of the Semitic language. This hypothesis helps to explain a number of facts that were not until now. Why were the ancient Egyptians calling themselves black if they did not call their darker skinned southern neighbors in this way? There's people do ask that question. Why didn't they call the Nehesiu Kim or whatever? Because this, what, the denominator, it says, because this denomination was secondary to the name of the earth, and because it was motivated in particular context of the an adaption opposite to the red Semitic earth man read in the Genesis of Egyptians. That is a hypothesis, explanation of this one hypothesis that he is looking over. It reconciles the two hitherto contradictory theories of Kemet, the black one, as reference to the color of the soil and its inhabitants. That's interesting. It helps to explain why Kemet, although it refers to the reality marked by the masculine gender, the earth is marked by a feminine gender through the influence of Semitic Adamat. It helps to explain the semantic match between Kemet, blacks, and Kemet to you, those of the black earth, as creatures formed by the black earth, and Kemet to you, those of the black nation. Interesting. It is difficult to posit the opposite path from Egyptian to Semitic. Indeed, the Proto-Semitic must have developed this association before arriving in his Asiatic homeland. In this case, on the red African earth. It says, the etymological relationship between red man and his earth is no longer transparent in Proto-Semitic and must have preceded this state. Furthermore, the gender of Adamat is consistent with the feminine gender of the earth in Semitic and does not need to be explained by that of Kemet, as it would be the case for the latter. See how people make that case? You see how scholars make that case for real? A knucklehead probably won't even know what his... Not a knucklehead. I'm sorry. Because even me, and I ain't a knucklehead... one could come away from this not even knowing what the scholar's position is, but he broke it down to say that the hypothesis about the skin tone and the cognates we have in Sumerian showing that they have a root for red, which means man, and the earth or the clay, and the color red. He's showing there's also a thought scheme in Kemet that had the same thing with the black soot, with the black man, and with the man being created by Khnum out of that soot on the potter's wheel. And he's shown how that reconciles a lot of questions, because come say, how could it be talking about the black soot? That mean it can be talking about the black soot and the black man. So he says it reconciles the two hitherto contradictory theories of Kemet, the black one. You see, the hitherto contradictory theories of Kemet, the black one. One theory is that it means the people, and another theory is that it means the land. Well, proposing, going over the scholar Diakonoff's work, he came to the conclusion that he said is true in order to reconcile, again, that argument. That, oh yeah, the man, the land, and the people of the nation could all share the same root, if I'm clear on that. So that was a good read. And again, I share it again for the people. It may pop up in French and you just got to translate it back, or it might not. It might just translate automatically for you. Yeah, no, let me see what y'all saying in the trap. Oh, yeah, they're going to say it mean the title. Yeah, and then they're going to act like they ain't hiding in the bushes and watching the video so they don't have to address, you know what I'm saying, so they don't have to address that. Anybody is prepared with the source work right in the chat to show them, look, this PhD black linguist say right here, bow, and give you a source on Kim meaning the title. Then, I mean, Kim the Red Crown being called black. Then I showed us how to speed get to the true source and just box them up. They won't be able to get past that. And so now I'm about to show you how to do shit faster since I've been accused of microwaving shit. Now I won't be the only one who can get to the bottom of things in a jiffy. Like what I mean, pertaining to the crown of Lower Egypt being called Kim, I gave out all the information to just back up anyone who makes actually a silly question like, well, why is the red crown called Kim? All they doing is showing they ain't got their homework. It's because dark, anything with a dark hue is considered Kim. That's why they call the woman Kim, the dark one. And that Kim is different than the Kim we hear today, which comes from the Kimberly name. That's different. But nevertheless. So that was his first article. Pretty good. I wasn't mad at that. They give us a few good sources. Pretty tight. What y'all doing in that chat? Somebody say, Dagger. Oh, I didn't took down the page yesterday. I only made it private so that I could do it right. And then I put it back up. And so it should be there and easily ready to find. All right. So let's go into his other article. Dang, he beat them up in this. Why not? It's just like your morning classwork, right? Let's go into his other article on the etymology of the term Kemet. See, because first we was just talking about Kim, and this is why I wanted to approach it from the ways I approached it in my own video as well. Now that he got it established that this color on these people is Kim, ain't no word for brown.
People didn't know why it wasn't no word for brown. Because brown is black and black is black. Do we got to whip that out? Mirror, mirror on the wall. Black is black. Why they was mad? How you could be mad that this color that y'all keep calling red and y'all supposed to be madder, madder? I'm so sad for my peoples. But look how dumb you gotta be to call this color red, blood. Like you overconvinced by some damn Egyptological homework that your brain ain't even working right. You calling this color red because the Egyptian books say it's red. So you said, I ain't red. That's crazy to me while I'm just looking at this picture. Y'all have been convinced, whatever mind tricks somebody done convinced you that this is red. Yet we could read the ancient Egyptian language and this color is Kim. Now, all right, you want a source on that? I'll give you two PhDs right now. We ain't taking YouTube scholars. You feel me? The etymology of Kemet, Egypt. One of the native names of ancient Egypt was Kemet. This is the one that survived in the Coptic as Kim and Kemi. Ain't that strange? See? It ain't no word Egypt in the Coptic. The etymology of this word is generally understood as meaning the black one. You think he lying? Go put that in the Coptic dictionary. It's everybody else who lying. It's everybody else. Let's see if he lying, dog. Golly, this is easy. C-O-P-T-I-C. No, he's not lying. Everyone else is. You could go to an online Coptic dictionary right now and see, is that brother lying? We're going to type in the word. This is what I'm going to put. He said, Kemi, I'm going to put K-E-M-I. That should be Egypt. Nope. All right, so let me get it different. See, I can't do the Coptic word because I used to use a Coptic. There you go. So I got to take that out and use the Coptic. Okay. Let's see if I got that right. All right. But in a minute, I'm just going to say the black land and make everybody mad. Oh, you got to put it with the X, not the K. I don't know the name of my Coptic symbol. Let's see if I do this right. All right, well, I'm going to do it the easier way. I don't know why you start doing stuff the hard way anyway. Let's go right here. Let's try Egypt. It must have too many words for Egypt. It's taking hella long. So when I put in Egypt, all you see is shit about black. Man, God, I can't make it up. That's what I'm trying to say. I just put in the word Egypt in a Coptic dictionary. Start reading the screen. Something Kemi, bruised, dark color like grapes, grapes of Egypt. Kemi, the black land, Egypt. So when the brother said you can trace Kemet back to black, it's starting to get hot. It's time to get on the water. I'm about to pull them skis out. Damn near today. But I ain't really ready. I'm about to though. But look at what he's saying. Look, the black land, Egypt. Oh, so it was K-H. I'm saying English letters, but this isn't a K or a H. It's like
you know, it's Coptic, so I'm disrespecting what the Coptic script is called. But nevertheless, when I clip on Kemet, it say the black, this land is in parentheses, is what they're trying to teach you. Look, land ain't on the word. Land is nowhere on the word Kemet. Don't let nobody fool you. Land is not on the word Kemet. So how you gonna call it a riparian land when land ain't even on the word? You got to put land in parentheses too and say that Kim only means riparian. See how you messing that up? So we was reading what the scholar said, and just to make sure, we just went and checked it. He got this in the and one in parentheses. He say the black one. So you go to a Coptic dictionary to see, is he making it up? They got the, but it ain't no the in this word either. And so it stands to say, right here say the black, right here say the black. When somebody say that Kemet is translated that way, etymologically they're not wrong. So Kemet, the black one. This is the translation offered by the Wordabunch of Arman and Grapo, okay? Several facts have led researchers to translate this word as the black one. The first of these is the existence of the Egyptian word kim, meaning to be black, and the feminine suffix t, both of which can be combined to form an adjective meaning black, or secondarily, a noun derived from this adjective via conversion, that is, without adding an additional affix. You see how good he broke that down? Because he a linguist for real. This the type of stuff motherfuckers act like you can't just break down to a person. I've been saying this the whole time. But let's break it down. The first of these is the existence of the Egyptian word kim, meaning to be black, and the feminine suffix t. So if you got something that means to be black and you put a feminine suffix on it, you just feminize the noun. That just means whatever that is black is feminine. It's like a black woman or a black feminine something. You feel me? So both of which can be combined to form an adjective meaning black. Both of which. Kim to black, or the with it feminized with the T, can form an adjective to mean black, or secondarily a noun derived from this adjective. A person being the black is a noun derived from the adjective. You see? Something that describes something, and then we're gonna withdraw, extract a noun from it. A person that is that color. Adjective via conversion, that is, without adding an additional affix. So he goes into the case of French to make a case, and he makes a very good case, but it ain't really relevant. I don't feel like reading too much, but I will. In French, for example, blanc is an adjective to which the feminine suffix he is added to give the feminine adjective blanche, or whatever. I don't read French. Through a process of conversion, white becomes a noun, blanche, or whatever, which may refer to a white woman. See? The problem is that unlike an adjective, blanc in French, Kim has a lot of homonyms. In ancient Egyptian, it says this is due to the part in the fact that the earliest stage of Pharaonic Egyptian did not transcribe vowels. If the situation was the same in French as it was in Egyptian, the adjective blanc, white, would be written BL, like blue, blue, ball, wheat, blue, etc. In Egyptian, the word Kemet, Egypt, could be a priori and having originally meant the black one, but could also have meant the complete, from the root kim, to be complete, or even have a lost etymology. The etymology of the word Germany dates back to the ancient people of the Germani, whose etymology, for example, is unknown. Interesting. See, I could have, like I said, that was interesting to learn, but I could have just skipped to this. Kim, black soil or black people. The etymology of Kim is as meaning black is acknowledged by the great majority of Egyptologists who define it either as a reference to the black color of the Nile silt or to the skin color of the ancient Egyptians. So, okay. So like, that ain't no blackologist shit. The etymology of Kemet, not Kim. The etymology of Kemet as meaning black is acknowledged by the great majority of Egyptologists who define it either as a reference to the black color of the Nile silt or to that of the skin color of the ancient Egyptians. You see what Egyptologists define it as? The latter meaning is mainly acknowledged by Egyptologists and other researchers of black African descent. So he's saying the people who say it means the black skin color is by Kemetologists, basically. Y'all. Us. But you know what I'm saying? And he's being clear on that. Now he's looking over the work of Fuma, in 1993 on Kemet, who proposed that it was a nation. I can't wait to get this book tomorrow to see what my good brother's view on Fuma's work in 1993 was. Can't wait to see that. Among the latter, however, a divergent hypothesis has been suggested. According to it, the etymology of Kemet, Egypt, has nothing to do with color black. So I wonder who else is working along these lines. But this is a African scholar, if I'm not incorrect. So don't act like everybody's intentions are politically motivated. I definitely don't think the Shimsu Heru's intentions are politically motivated. I think this rooted in their knowledge of the subject and wanting to state their case. So, for example, according to Fuma, 1993, the meaning of Kemet is not that of the black one, but that of national territory. All right. So we're going to go over his argument. This hypothesis is based on several arguments. The first one deals with Coptic data. See, I love to see scholars go over other scholars' work like this and let me know you're thorough. His first argument, Fuma's first argument, Coptic is the last stage of the ancient Egyptian language. In the Sahidic dialect of Coptic, the name of Egypt is Kema, while in the Baharic dialect, it is Kemi. At first glance, the Coptic seems to suggest that Kemet has nothing to do with darkness. One of the forms for being black is indeed Kemon, or whatever, and is different to the word for Egypt as far as the vowels and numbers of consonants are concerned, as pointed out by Fuma. So it's different, okay? Coptic verbal morphology. A reader unfamiliar with Coptic grammar may assume that one is dealing with two completely different words, such as the French bleu and bobli, or fat, which have neither the same number of consonants nor the same vowels. Unfortunately, Fuma seems unaware that the Egyptian and Coptic have a verbal morphology largely based on a high degree of apophony. We definitely don't want to read words that we don't know what they mean. So apophony. Let me see. But a change in the quality of vowels and sounds to indicate grammatical change, okay?
Now I want to hear the lady say the word, so I'm going to go to the DEF. And we're going to hear her say it real quick. Come on, lady, say it.
Apophony.
Oh, I said apophony. See, that's why you got to listen to him say it.
Apophony. Apophony.
All right, so we got some apophony jumping off. Hopefully, I ain't the only one who just added a new word to my vocabulary. We got some apophony jumping off. All right, now, see, these languages have a verbal morphology consisting of a root made up of a consonant sequence providing lexical information, a template, a mold made of a fixed number of consonants, and a particular vowel sequence providing grammatical information. One root can be associated with a different template given a different grammatical functions. For example, the root KM in Coptic is associated with darkness. The CC template associates this root and others with the infinitive. Thus, when associated with this template, the root KM becomes comb or hmm-om, becoming black. XM becomes comum in Bahoric, the root HM associated with heat when associated with the template CCOC, whatever, is realized as home or whatever, get hot. This is what Fupa seems to have understood in his later work. Should we conclude that Kim Kimi and their ancestors, Kemet, Egypt, had nothing to do with the color black? The answer is no. Coptic, although, descends from Pharaonic Egyptian, differs from it in several ways. Descended from Pharaonic Egyptian, differs from it in several ways. And in this case, the adjectives derived from KM to be black and the Coptic are obviously derived from words belonging to other grammatical categories of the late hieroglyphic Egyptian stage. We know this for several reasons. First of all, the hieroglyphic feminine marker of nouns and adjectives, T, has historically been lost, leaving its absence to regularly match with the final vowel, E, in the Coptic Sahiric and I in Baharic. We can see it with examples in one, and he gives examples here, how the T on all of these words is falling off. From Pharaonic Egyptian to Sahidic and Baharic. If Cam came from a word only ending with a T, one would expect their final vowel to be EI, which is not the case. A great analogy in breaking down Fuma's argument in just a few bars. Now, the evidence of pre, do me a favor, let me check the chat too. Tap in with my people. Is the Kim glyph a burning charcoal or a croc's tail? That is inconclusive at this point, but it is not inconclusive that it is defined as, it is not inconclusive that it is defined as black. But that is a whole nother research question, my good brother. You know what I mean? Like, we'd have to do a different type of research looking at all of primaries and see if one of them gives us a clue to whether it is charcoal or black. Looking at, see if the use of the word is ever used close to charcoal or anything like that. And that'll be a whole nother survey. So right now, we're just looking at etymology of Kemet and less which symbol it is. So we're more likely to be present, says, we are more likely to be in the presence of the word from another grammatical category derived from the KM. If the hypothesis of Kemet deriving from an adjective was true, one could expect Kemi, form as a masculine adjective and kimikima as a feminine adjective, which we do not have. Okay. However, we find the Greek transcription, and I used to be proud when I could read Greek. I can't read Greek no more. I'm about to get all my stuff back. Like, you feel me? I should put this in a Greek. Oh, I'm capping. Because look, when I put this in the, look how stuff be happening. I put this in the Google and look at this document from UCLA, and it's kind of saying something like Pa Kim, look. But it say XM for Horace the Jr., whatever. I don't want to misdo that. I was just only looking to see what this word actually meant and if they would give us a definition. And so since I don't think they're giving me one, I'm just going to skip it. Of the Egyptian theonym Hor Pakim. So he said right here, Horus the Black. See what I just seen? So when I went to this document from UCLA, when we talked about Horus the Black, and I told us we had Horus the Black, and now we see however we find a Greek transcription of, I guess what that means is the Egyptian theonym Hor Pakim. Pakim is the Black. Horus the Black or the Black Kim is transcribed by King in the Greek. Oh, he killed him. Oh, he killed him. Oh, he bull rushed, killed him. Because what the other scholar was saying is that this other Kimmy, it don't mean nothing that got to do with Black because he had this other root in a different dialect of the Coptic. But he just went and said, however, we find in the Greek transcriptions of the word, the Egyptian theonym. Hold on. Now we on names. I just be liking to make point because when the neurons in my brain fire off, I don't ignore them. So I ain't scatterbrained. I just want to say a theonym is the proper name of a deity, right? So if you, you know, if you're a god and you got a name, you're a theonym. What is a pseudonym? Huh? A pseudonym is a fictitious name, especially one used by an author. So if you're writing books under a fake name, you is a pseudo. Period. My books say Jonathan Owens on the goddamn front.
Pseudonym.
I'm keeping it a buck. Fuck that. Shit, that just popped up in my head real quick. Like, hold on, we talking about theonyms. Well, let's talk about all these books written by people with pseudonyms.
Pseudonym.
Shit. Anyway, what did I do? Just teach you something or not? Because if I didn't, then you knew that already. Why you think I put Jonathan Owens on the front of my book? But look, I'm just keeping that a buck. But that don't mean the work bad. But it's just when we're dealing with facts, the fact is if you got a fictitious name and especially one used by an author, that's called a
pseudonym. Pseudonym.
So a lot of pseudo works come out under pseudonyms. This is just things we learn. You feel me? I got rap homies who wouldn't even take on a rap name for that reason. I was like, what's your problem? I was like, nah, fool, I'm this. That's my name. But anyway, damn, that was a quick dagger out the cut. We be having like magi shurikens. You wouldn't want to have to deal with that, huh? Calling people names. So I keep going to the wrong article. There we go. Because he's going to keep beating them up. He beat them up with Hor Pakim. Horus the Black and the Black Kim is translated by Kima, which confirmed, or by Kim, which confirms the existence of the adjective Kim, Kim, Kim. Kim, Kim in the pre-Coptic. Now we have how you say this goddamn name? Vicetul, whatever, who noted this fact, reports that this vocalization, which did not survive for the root KM, survived for another pharaonic adjective in Coptic. This is the case with that name of Wab, a type of ancient Egyptian priest whose name was derived from the adjective Wab, pure.
Oh, that's very interesting. In which the Coptic gave Weeb in Sidetic and Web in Baharic. Another argument confirms this fact. Confirming this fact comes from the testimony of the Latin-speaking Greek writer Plutarch. See, this is what I keep telling people. This is where the Egypt Black Land thing comes from. I said that and no one hasn't corrected me yet. I'll be loving to get corrected. Correcting is not a negative thing. It makes me better, a better, stronger source of information. You know what I'm saying? And so don't ever feel like you're going to get no type of way. It's only about the way that we address each other when we approach with corrections. You know what I'm saying? And so I've been corrected by all of my peers throughout this journey. Asar, Ujahu. We've done the similar to keep each other on point. Brother Ankh, be like, hold up on that part. He'll show you out about that part to make sure it works. So you feel me? We all peer review each other, so to speak. Not like that. I'm not talking about really. I'm just talking about in the, you know, when you come out with a claim, someone want to make sure you keeping it right and solid. So I said it was Plutarch who first made the claim about the black soot. And here we got the claim. In chapter 33 of his work, Isis and Osiris, Plutarch explains in these terms the meaning of the name of the country of the ancient Egyptian language latter. In the latter, language of the latter, it says, in addition, we name Egypt because its lands are black amongst all, like the black of the eye. Kemia. It says, in this sentence, Plutarch teaches us that the name of Egypt was Kemia, which strongly resembles the Baharic form of the term, which as we have seen, Kemi. We also learn that from this text in Plutarch's time, ancient Egyptians considered that the name of their country, Kemi, was linked to the black color. More precisely, the color of the earth in this country, described as the blackest amongst all. Interestingly, this connection was also made, according to the author, through the relationship between the name of Egypt and the black of the eye. That is to say, the pupil. Why is this reference to this black reality rather than to another? Why this reference to this black reality rather than to another? Because there was, in hieroglyphics Egyptian, a word derived from the root kem, black, which meant pupil. Like the name of Egypt, because it is derived from the root kem, black, it could only have been a nominalized adjective. Plutarch, in his Egyptian informants, referenced that to the black eye rather than the hair or some other black reality was motivated by the fact that the two terms were perfect homophones, which one might have expected since they both were nominalized feminine gender adjectives. I love this homework. We therefore have an additional argument for the vocalization of adjectives formed from kem, black, with an E in the pre-Coptic, and therefore the formation of the name of Egypt through this process. Fuma's argument related to the different vocalization of the name of Egypt and of the verbs and adjectives associated with the color black in Coptic does not hold an identical vocalization, does not hold since an identical vocalization is attested for another feminine noun derived from an adjective in Pharaonic Egyptian. Now, the evidence for sub-Saharan African languages. See, this brother has done a lot of work on this stuff. Fulmer's second arguments deal with the sub-Saharan African languages. As reported by this author in 1993, there are a number of words which resembles Kemet in the form and whose meaning is similar to that of territory, but have no relation to the color black.
In Compton, we got Cami Egypt, Bossa Calm Farm, whatever, Dior. I'm not reading all of these. He got a bunch of cognates. All right. Now, there are several issues with the argument. First of all, Fuma only provides one with a list of words that resemble each other in form and meaning. See, that's what some people do. And this is what a real linguist is going to tell you. Don't be impressed by seeing a list of words that don't nobody explain nothing about. This is a PhD linguist scrutinizing another person who's making so-called historical comparative linguistics between and two languages or whatever. But he's breaking down. There is several issues with this argument. First of all, Fuma only provides one with a list of words that resemble each other in a form and meaning. The comparative method was not used here. So just because somebody presents some words that resemble each other in form and meaning, they still have to show you what is called the comparative method. The latter aims to, and then when I keep hearing people say that, but it don't match up with how the scholars use the term. But anyway, the latter aims to at comparing related languages, establishing phonetic matches, and reconstructing the hypothetical ancestor language of all these languages. In the case of the words listed above, etymologically meaning land or territory, as suggested by Fuma, the comparative method would allow one to predict the related Egyptian form after establishing regular sound correspondences between the words of the listed languages. So this right here is a simple sentence to understand in your life and to go into the understanding of a statement, because this is that beat up the pseudo-linguist sentence. You feel me? And again, trust me, the brother is giving you the homework. And so it says, it is impossible to know if that, it says it is impossible to know if that is the case for Kemet, since Fuma did not do this work. Even if it were the case, it could not be excluded that this hypothetical originally mean of the territory did not coexist with the root Kem meaning black, and that the choice of Kemet as the name of Egypt does not motivated by this homonymy between the two forms. All right. And that was such a long sentence, it was hard for me to get through, but apparently I did. So, Kim, kind of land. The third argument used by Fuma deals with the existence in Egyptian of a toponym Kim-R, which was used to name a thribis. It says, according to Fuma, this term cannot be translated as the Great Black One any more than Kemet, the name of the locality in the Delta, could be translated as the Black One, unless one assumes that the ancient Egyptian image of their country territory as a human being. He said this hypothesis being strongly rejected by the author. According to Fuma, I know I butchered his name, but that's the best I could get it. According to Fuma, the etymological meaning of Kemet and Kem-R is cadastral land or land property. Kem-R must mean something like rural domain or agricultural land or fattening meadow. R for forage and whatever. The author asserts that Kim and Kem-R and Kim and Kemet are not linked to the color black, but both refer to the notion of cadastral land, and the T of Kemet translated the concept of the territory collectively, or city. Fuma's fourth argument deals with the phrase Ta and Kemet. The first degree of the translation results in the land of Egypt, or the country of Egypt.
in the same way that a country of England can be translated the country of England. The second degree of translation taken into account the etymology of the name of the country resulting in the land of the black. In the same way that the country of England could translate as the land of the angels.
Huh? I guess if you,
it's cool. A third degree of translation. Excuse me, other stuff be on my mind, I can hardly read. The third degree of translation taking into account the omitted referent qualified by black and omitted in the expression Ta and Kim would either result in the land of the black earth, if we consider that the name originally qualified as black was land, just as the country of England should be translated as the land of the people called angels. Anglis? Whatever. It says, this translation of Ta and Kemet by the earth of the black earth is described by Fulmer as absurd. This, he says, is an argument showing that Kemet cannot mean black earth. We personally do not see how etymology of Kemet as referring to the color of the ground is invalidated by expressions of Ta and Kemet, as shown by the example of the country of England. Yeah, he broke that down. Okay, so now he's going to look at Mboli's work. And it's a shame that he didn't have to spend so much time dealing with Mboli. So for Kemet, a collective of territories traversed by water, Mboli, 2010, we read this. Another author opposing the translation of Kemet by the black one is Mboli, 2010. This author states, however, no Egyptian document over 3,000 years of history ever refers to any link between Kemet, Egypt, and Kem Black. This absence is all the more curious as the ancient Egyptians used to make links between entities and notions which were pronounced in the same way. Example, Men Remich conceived as the tears of Ra. Now look at this. This assertion is contradicted by a passage from a text inscribed on the walls of the temple of Edfu. Damn. Hold on. So you telling me that some scholar named Mboli made an argument based on a claim that no Egyptian argument over 3,000 years in history ever referred to any link between Kemet, Egypt, and Kem Black. And then in one sentence, the PhD says this assertion is contradicted by a passage from a text inscribed on the walls of the Temple of Edfu, as noted by Oriel in 1998. And this quote is, because black Egypt is said to be the eye of Osiris, it is his pupil. But we got a scholar named Mboli who says that never happened. Interesting. Now, let's see. Because black is said to be the eye of Osiris, Edfu, and he gives us the case on that. This is a replica of the Greek quote from Plutarch. Interesting. So, is something on the temple of Edfu carved on the walls a replica of a Greek quote from Plutarch? Because the Ptolemies lived after Plutarch, correct? So are they saying they took a Greek quote, and since they was Greeks, they wrote it on the walls of Kemet? Yes. No. How could that be? Oh, you know what? How long did... Nah, that can't be. I'm wondering. How long was the Ptolemies? I thought that ended at about 30 BC. But I could be wrong. But anyway, in addition, we name Egypt because its lands are black amongst them all, like the black eye of Kemah. A direct link was therefore made between the Egyptian pharaonic scribes about the black of the eye of the name of Kemet. So Mboli's wrong here. Coming out the gate. Like tripped over the gatepost. You know, if you ever seen somebody try to come out the gate, but the gate ain't open yet, and they run, they jump the gun and just trip all over the gatepost. He came up out the gate, bow, tripped, hit his face on the rock, on the ground. Let me see. So look, the name of Athribis. Another argument proposed by Mboli deals with the number of toponyms. Interesting. Kemet, Athribis, blah, blah, blah. He got all these toponyms with Kim, basically Kim at the root. In the first place, wow. Hold on, let's keep it a buck. When a scholar address another scholar with in the first place, in the first place? Wow. He just like, hold on, blood, in the first place, the author does not consider the possibility that the Kim mentioned here are nominalized adjectives referring to the color black, but do not qualify the same reality as Kemet, Egypt. So that's in the first place. However, this is what seems to suggest the gender difference between Kim and most of the toponyms cited by Mboli, and which suggests that they do not qualify the same reality. A fortitory if, all right, what is fortitory? Why? Because don't just be reading for other people. Read for yourself too. From the stronger, okay. From the stronger argument. Feel me? Affortatory if they are not nouns derived from other grammatical categories, as he suggests. Instead, the author assumes. So did Diop assume or did Mboli assume? Instead, the author assumes that these terms, Kim, are one and the same word, meaning the territory crossed by the water, and that the T of Kemet, Egypt, and that of Kemet, Athrobis, nome of Lower Egypt, are the mark of the collective Egypt and the name constituting several territories. This hypothesis is consistent, but not very convincing. Why not have taken into account the possibility that for the toponyms other than Kim, Egypt, black refers to something other than the color of the silt of the Nile? For example, Kim, our region of the Bitter Lakes located east of the Nile Delta, appears in the hymn to Osiris from the pyramid text. It is determined there by the sign of the wall, which, for example, led Allen in 2005 to translate it as a large black wall. As the Verdinus 1978 inventory has shown, the Koch hymn reading is unlikely, having been confirmed by only one questionable example. Likewise, The word Khem in a Thebes name is regularly written with the determinative of a bull, which suggests that this is a reference to a black bull, a heraldic animal of the city and its nome. This cannot be, at least in most cases, a Ka-Khem black bull reading, since the sign represented a bull following the sign for black in all or almost all cases where the two signs coexist in the designation of a Thebes. To the questions asked by Mboli, why does the name of Thebes have the same name as the whole country? Referring to the spelling effectively similar to that of Khem in Egypt, we will answer that there are many similar spellings of that name of Thebes and his nome, to which is added the determinative of the bull, which one again shows that although phonetically similar at one point in their history, the name of Egypt and the name of that city and that of the city of the name of Thebes are quite different. As Vernus further recalled, there was originally no difference between the name of the capital of the nome and the name of the nome territory, with the exception originally from the bulwark. Bulwark, what is that, man? I don't even know. If you don't know, now you know. Come on through. So that's a defense wall, huh?
Bulwark.
A defense wall. Okay. Oh, that's he making some bombs.
Bulwark.
He's dropping bombs. Exception really from the bulwark and from the sign characteristic characterizing the second. From the Middle Kingdom onwards, in the same context, the spelling of the type Khem Ur and Kemet alternate in Egypt. The reason proposed by the long tradition of Egyptologists is that by the time of the final R in Khem Ur has weakened into a J before phonetically disappearing and seeing a weakening of the W into a vowel. The loss of the feminine and the collective T at the same time led to confusion between the writings of a Thebes' name, whether it was Khem Ur, Khem, or Kemet, or Kemet Waret. Likewise, the Kemet spelling of a Thebes is not conformed. It is not confirmed by Hannigan. It's not confirmed by Hannigan's dictionary. More recent than Armand and Grapper's Wörterbuch. So it's not confirmed by Hannigan's dictionary. Gardner in 1914, blah, 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 Fetch and Grandet and others have explained how Khem were all variations of the same name of the nome of a Thebes. One can, however, wonder if this meaning of the name of Egypt is used several millennia after the first attestation of Kemet actually account for this etymology. Another link can be found in the regular association of Khem, black, on the right, the red, and on side of Kemet, Egypt, and on the Jeshurun, the desert. The fact that ancient Egyptians regularly opposed, The fact that the ancient Egyptian regularly opposed in his language Khem, black, to Jesher, red, that the first in the language to be associated with Osiris and the Egyptians, and that the second to be there with Seth, associated with foreigners, that the name of Egypt be formed from the root of the same name to be Khem, black, and that the name of the desert be formed from the root of the same name to that of Jesher, red, and that Osiris be associated with Egypt and Seth with the desert. Let me read that again. And that Osiris be associated with Egypt and Seth with the desert, that the testimony of the contemporary languages of Pharaonic Egyptian and Coptic show that the vocalization of the name of Egypt was that was what one would expect from a nominalized adjective derived from the root Kim Black, shows that there is no serious reason to question the etymology of Kemet Egypt as the black. Dang, I should have had my bombs and I'm pressing the buttons, but ain't no sound coming out. And so it seems what the good brother Sandro Capo Chichi, PhD linguist, who got his PhD to further his research in African art studies, seems very thorough in just this little article. Because what he displayed to me is that he looked over all of the updated work on the subject. He gave his stance on all of the arguments from Fuma to Mboli. He showed how some of these scholars were incorrect or inconsistent in their arguments. And after addressing all of their arguments in this short presentation, he came to the conclusion that none of these scholars has presented any valid information to divorce the meaning of blackness from the name Kemet. So here is this article for us to scrutinize. And that's a very good one. So he says, Scholar Mboli versus 1998. No, this document actually was written last year, 2001. And so I see what you're saying. But when you're a scholar, you have to go over everybody's claims on the subject. At least the ones, the PhDs and the people that I read, they do that. They lay out everyone's argument. And then they show you how they form their conclusion. If you don't, you would be leaving your reader to get ambushed by other arguments after they stand on your work. So suppose someone's standing on your work and your work ain't addressed these other arguments, then you can be ambushed. And so I just wanted to get a final reading of those two documents up here. You know what I mean? So that they could be on my page. But I definitely think I want to. Oh, yeah, you said jet skis. You got me wanting to go down and do some work. I'll be working on my own skis. You feel me? I'll be doing all that type of stuff. It'd be fun. Working on RC cars and jet skis. And I got my thing from 57 miles per hour up to 68 by messing with it and doing stuff. So if I get it to crack 75, it's just an old 2003 ski. It ain't nothing like flossy. But if I get it up to 75, it's my goal. So I'm gonna try to get it up to 75. So when I be coming running past people on their new ski and they be like, dang, that motherfucker running, it be because of that. So I'm gonna end this video and thank y'all all. And then I'll be back for a Zoom and that type of chill. If y'all are willing to participate, come back around. But for the nature of my content on my video page being short and concise, I will try to end this one at 2 hours, which isn't really that short. But we got the reading into the video. I'd like to thank y'all for watching at such an early time. It's just now 9 o'clock where I'm at. I want to give all my men advice to start waking up early. We spent a lot of time burning that midnight oil. At this time, it's inconsistent with how
the sun rotates. When the sun get up, you get up. And when the sun get ready to go down, get ready to go down. We learn those type of things before civilizations, and now we burn, we get nocturnal and everything. But I'm going to tell you something about nocturnal people aren't hardly as economic. Notice that. Nocturnal people ain't, I don't want to say nocturnal people don't got as much bread as the opposite, but sometimes it'll be the case. Because really you can't do as many transactions or set up business deals at nighttime. And so like right now I'm talking to y'all, it's 9 a.m. I just did a 2-hour stream, 2 hours of Egyptian studies. I did an hour working in the crypto space before I started this video, and it's only 9 a.m. where I'm at. So I'll be going to sleep about 7 o'clock. Sometimes when we be on them nighttime streams, like I said, I couldn't even talk. I'm laying in the bed. I'm about to make my wife mad. I'm screaming about Egypt. We trying to sleep at 10 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. So, yeah, I'm going to come back and do some more. Thanks for tapping.